Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to Millennium TV Headline News. This is Ishra Jahan with the top stories. Cuba arrests dozens of human rights protesters before Obama's arrival. President Obama touches down in Cuba, launching history-making visit. Paris terrorist suspect was planning new attack. Hikers discover a human skull near the Hollywood sign in LA. Florida biologist to investigate major fish kill. President Obama's weekly address. Viewers, now the detail. Just hours before President Obama landed Sunday in Cuba for his historic visit to the communist island, Cuban authorities arrested more than 50 dissidents who were marching to demand improved human rights. Members of the group known as the Ladies in White are used to routine. They march each Sunday after mass at a church in a suburb of Havana called Miramar, and usually get arrested and detained for hours or days. Some in the group thought Cuban authorities would back off this Sunday out of respect for Obama's visit. But Solo, one of the founding members who has been marching since 2003, said while walking on the church Sunday morning that maybe they would be allowed to protest without getting arrested. The wheels of the Air Force One touched down at Jos Mati International Airport for the first time ever in 4:19 p.m. Sunday, kicking off a history-making presidential visit and breaking decades of tense relations with communist Cuba. It's the same single runway airport or the CIA once bombed in the 1960s and whose broken down Russian-built airplanes and colorful antiquated terminals give testimony to the impact of 50 years of US sanctions and diplomatic isolation. But as he descended the stairway under an umbrella, President Obama was greeted warmly on the tarmac by Cuban Foreign Minister Bruno Rodriguez, who presented First Lady Michelle Obama and her daughters with flowers. A small crowd gathered on the reviewing stand, but their cheers were subdued by the 84-degree drizzle. President Obama's three-day visit will focus on deepening long-neglected commercial ties between the United States and Cuba, but also drawing a harder line on human rights abuses by the Castro government. Just hours before his arrival, Cuban authorities arrested more than 50 human rights activists at the weekly Ladies in White protest outside Havana. But first, Obama headed to a Havana hotel where he met with American diplomats at the newly reopened embassy, who have been working to normalize relations with Cuba since Pope Francis mediated a thawing of U.S.-Cuban relations in 2014. Having a U.S. embassy means we are effectively able to advance our values, our interests, and understand more effectively the Cuban people's concerns, Obama told them. This is a historic visit and a historic opportunity. Then Obama and the entire first family, the first lady, daughter Sasha and Malia, and mother-in-law Marian Robinson, did some sightseeing in heavy rain in old Havana, including a visit to the cathedral that is the seat of the Roman Catholic Church in Cuba and where Pope Francis celebrated Mass last year. There, Obama met with Cardinal James Ortega, who celebrated Palm Sunday Mass there Sunday morning after a procession through Old Havana. On Monday, Obama will meet one-on-one with Cuban President Raul Castro, the brother of the retired revolutionary leader Fidel Castro. Tuesday, Obama meets with dissidents and addresses the Cuban people directly in speech to be televised across the island. Finally, he will engage in baseball diplomacy, taking in an exhibition game between the Tampa Bay Rays and Cuban Nationals before departing for Argentina Tuesday afternoon. Obama arrived with a delegation so large it needed multiple planes. A White House press charter arrived Saturday and a support plane helped bring 11 CEOs and 39 members of Congress Sunday. Also on the Air Force One, the family of Jackie Robinson, the legendary president to visit Cuba since Calvin Coolidge, arrived by battleship in 1928 to address the Pan-American Conference, a piece of history that Obama acknowledged to embassy staff. It took him 3 days to get there, Obama said. It only took me 3 hours. accused terrorist Sara Abdeslam, suspected of planning the Paris attacks that killed 130 people, has told investigators he was planning another major assault when he was arrested in a Brussels suburb last week, a Belgian official said Sunday. It may be the reality because we have found a lot of weapons, heavy weapons, in the first investigations, and we have found a new network around him in Brussels. Belgium's Foreign Minister Didier Reynders said at a counter-terrorism forum in Brussels. He added that authorities was discovered dozens of suspects and we are sure there are others. Interpol warned that Abdeslam's arrest may encourage any accomplices to attempt to flee to Europe or elsewhere. The International Policing Agency advised extra vigilance at border crossing for its 190 member countries. Abdeslam, 26, was taken into custody Friday by heavily armed police who swept into the apartment guns blazing, less than half a mile from his family home in the Molenbeek neighborhood. Paris prosecutor Francois Molin said Abdeslam has told Belgian authorities he was involved in the November 13 Paris attacks and was supposed to die that night. Abdeslam said he dropped off the other attacks before changing his mind, dumping his own suicide vest and fleeing back to Belgium, Molin said. Abdeslam was stopped while crossing the border back into Belgium, but security officials allowed him to pass through the checkpoint. Authorities believe the vest was found days later on a Parisian street. The Islamic State claimed responsibility for the bloody series of assaults at cafes, a rock concert and a soccer game. Several attackers also died last night, including Abdeslam's brother Brahim, who blew himself up. Salah Abdeslam lawyer Sven Maris told the Belgian news agency RTBF that he would fight extradition to France. He was also said that he would file a complaint against Molins, possibly as soon as Monday, for violating the secrecy of the investigation at a news conference Saturday. "It is a mistake I cannot let pass," Maris said. Maris acknowledged that Abdeslam was involved in the attacks but said his client has extremely cooperated with authorities since his arrest. Abdeslam facing a hearing on Wednesday, but Maris said he won't argue for his client's release. Abdeslam was wounded in Friday's raid that resulted in his arrest, but he was released from a hospital into police custody Saturday. Abdeslam said another man arrested Friday have been charged with terrorist murder and participation in a terrorist group. A third man arrested in the operation in Molenbeek was charged with being a member of the terrorist organization and aiding and abetting criminals. A female detained was charged with aiding and abetting was released. Belgian prosecutors said a second woman was released without charges. The LAPD is investigating a very old human skull found in LA's Crypt Park on Saturday afternoon. The skull has been by hikers near the Hollywood sign at about 2 p.m. and the LAPD homicide investigators and Los Angeles County Coroner's Office officials arrived at the scene around the Brush Canyon Trail shortly thereafter. Lieutenant Ryan Schatz and the LAPD called the skull very old, though he didn't know how long it had been in the park or the person's cause of death. Media reports. Investigators added that they plan to monitor the Griffith Park area throughout the night. Access to the area was closed off for the night. As of Saturday night, no other body parts have been located. The skull's discovery comes just for 2 years after human remains were found in the same area. In 2014, remains including a human head were found near the Hollywood sign. A dog found the head on the hiking trail, and authorities later found hands and feet of what was determined to be the body of Harvey Medellin. Grablail Campos Martinez was later found guilty of his murder and sentenced to 25 years of life in prison. The LAPD has not yet commented if the two discoveries could be related.
There is part of a trail there. It's quite some distance from the main trail, but there is a small trail that goes, and I think they were trying to connect, they were trying to blaze a path between two main trails. That's how they came across it. Due to hours of darkness ending, homicide processed, and the coroner did go out and recover the top half of the skull. They're going to go out there and fully process the scene because the area is very dense with brush and overgrowth. So it's not something they can handle during hours of darkness.
A Florida Fish and Wildlife Fisheries biologist is set to examine the possible causes of a major fish kill that left up to 15 different species of fish dead and dying in the Indian River Lagoon, authorities said, the state agency reported Sunday. But the news came as little comfort for residents like Courtney Yelly, 80, of the Cocoa Beach. The one-time Pennsylvania resident moved to this tourist haven 8 years ago, settling in a condominium along the Banana Rivers for its scenic view. Sunday, he awoke to the sights and smell of hundreds of fish floating listlessly in the murky brown waters of the river. There in the small lapping waves rippling near their dock, he saw decaying carcasses of flounder, puffer fish, and other other spaces. It's terrible. It's just the worst I've ever seen, he said of the Fishkill, which began to be reported late Friday and Saturday, stretching along the lagoon from Titusville to the Pineda Causeway area. Something has gone wrong and I don't know what it is. It's just sickening, Yellow said. Florida Fish and Wildlife Conservation Commission officials confirmed calls have been made to the state agency's Fishkill hotline. An operator there also said water fisheries biologist had been contacted by late Sunday. Florida Fish and Wildlife spokesman Greg Workman has also reached by Florida Today, but he said he was attempting to gather more information. According to the commission's website, 100 puffer and sheep spade fish were reported dead at the Watts Park and Merritt Island on Friday. Sunday, the dead fish washed up along shorelines and floated along portions of the river. In some areas, including the Bay Club condo complex of Management Causeway in Cocoa Beach, witnesses reported the unusual sight of seeing hundreds of fish poking their heads above water, gasping for air. There were also videos posted by area residents showing stringers and other fish groups close to the shoreline. By Saturday, residents described the scenes as disturbing and added that a heavy fishy odor was permeating the area. Bob Pills was preparing to leave his family's home in Rockledge on Sunday when he decided to go to a riverside park where he spotted dead crabs, flounder and other fish. There were all kinds of blue crabs climbing up to get out of water. None of us had ever seen this. I'm just so totally upset, Pills said, adding that the river life was literally dying at his feet, unable to breathe. Family members told him that it was more evidence of pollution and algae sucking the oxygen out of water. He believes more should be done to help Brevard County accommodate growth and development to help protect and preserve the surrounding environment. We need to immediate action on this, he said. The causes of the fish kill were not immediately known, but although the river has been experiences what ecologists describe as a brown tide, leaving behind clumps of rotted dead vegetarian and depleted oxygen levels. Brown tide returned to the Indian River Lagoon in January after it first bloomed in 2012. In November 2014, Florida Today reported cashfish, flounder, mullet, sailor shoas, pinfish, red drum, sheep's bed, and trout were all parts of hundreds of dead fish in Merritt Island canals. Also a possible factor in this weekend's fish kill, El Nino. The weather pattern typically brings heavier than normal rains and has been cited by ecologists as triggering damaged polluted runoff into the lagoon. In this week's addresses, the president discussed his decision to nominate Chief Judge Merrick Garland to Supreme Court of the United States. Chief Judge Garland has earned the respect of both Democrats and Republicans through his years of public service. The president made clear that even though we are in the midst of a volatile political season, we should treat the appointment of a Supreme Court justice seriously. The president repeated his call for Republicans in the United States Senate to give the Chief Judge Garland a fair hearing and a vote. The president did his job, now senators should do theirs and quickly move to consider the president's nominee.
Hi, everybody. One of the most consequential responsibilities our Constitution grants a president is appointing a Supreme Court justice. The men and women who sit on the Supreme Court safeguard our rights. They ensure that ours is a system of laws, not of men. And they're given the essential task of applying the principles written into our founding documents to the most challenging questions of today. So this is a duty I take very seriously. It requires me to set aside short-term politics in order to maintain faith with our founders. And on Wednesday, after weeks of consultations with Republicans, Democrats, and leaders across the country, I selected a nominee whose unmatched experience and integrity have earned him the respect and admiration of both parties, Chief Judge Merrick Garland. Judge Garland grew up in my hometown of Chicago with parents who taught him to work hard and deal fairly. As a young lawyer, he left a lucrative private firm to work for half as much in public service. Eventually, he oversaw the federal response to the Oklahoma City bombing, working side by side with first responders, victims, and their families to bring justice for an unspeakable crime. And everywhere he went during that investigation, he carried with him in his briefcase the program from the memorial service with each of the victims' names inside. For the last 19 years, Judge Garland has served on what's known as the second highest court in the land, the D.C. Circuit Court, including the last 3 years as Chief Judge. On the bench, he's shown a dedication to protecting our basic rights, a conviction that powerful voices must not be allowed to drown out those of everyday Americans, an understanding that justice isn't simply abstract legal theory, it affects people's daily lives, and a spirit of decency, modesty, and even-handedness in his work. Judge Garland is admired for his courtesy, his devotion to family, and his civic-mindedness. For the past 18 years, he served as a tutor for young students at a local D.C. elementary school. During my time as president, through three separate Supreme Court appointments, in conversations with Republicans and Democrats alike, one name came up more than any other, Merrick Garland. I understand that we're in the middle of an especially noisy and volatile political season, but at a time when our politics are so polarized, when norms and customs of our political rhetoric seem to be corroding, this is precisely the time we should treat the appointment of a Supreme Court justice with the seriousness it deserves. Because our Supreme Court is supposed to be above politics, not an extension of politics, and it should stay that way. So I ask Republicans in the Senate to give Judge Garland the respect he has earned. Give him a hearing. Give him an up or down vote. To deny it would be an abdication of the Senate's constitutional duty. It would indicate a process for nominating and confirming judges that is beyond repair. It would make it increasingly impossible for any president, Republican or Democrat, to carry out their constitutional function. To go down that path would jeopardize our system of justice, it would hurt our democracy, and it would betray the vision of our founding. I've fulfilled my constitutional duty. Now it's time for senators to do theirs. I hope that they take the time to reflect on the importance of this process to our country. I hope they'll act fairly, and I hope they'll work in a bipartisan fashion to confirm Merrick Garland to the Supreme Court. That's how we can uphold our pledge to liberty and justice for all, for our time and for generations to come. Thanks, everybody, and have a good weekend.
Viewers, let's have a look at Millennium TV headline news recap. Cuba arrests dozens of human rights protesters before Obama's arrival. President Obama touches down in Cuba, launching history-making visit. Paris terror suspect was planning new attack. Hikers discover a human skull near the Hollywood sign in LA. Florida biologists to investigate major fish kill. President Obama's weekly address. You are up to date with the top stories so far here on Millennium TV, and don't forget to log into www.millenniumtv.net. Thank you and stay with Millennium TV. Allah Hafiz.